Test.
I
Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you so much for your son, Jesus, his death, his burial, his resurrection, from save us from our sins. Father, thank you for that, that leads us to be here today. Thank you for the impacts on our lives that you have been. Father, we praise you for this group of Christians that gathers together every Sunday. And Father, we thank you for the people across the world who are hearing all the messages that are being spread about your love, about your sacrifice for us. And Father, we pray for the efforts in India. We pray for the efforts across the world to bring your word to people who don't know about you. Father, bless us tonight, that we will be uplifted, that we will learn more about you, that we will take that and apply that. Bless us this week as we celebrate this country. Father, we thank you for the freedom of worship that we have in this country that others don't have. In Jesus we pray, amen.
Thank you. Well, as you know, several weeks ago, Wayne had an announcement for us that he had taken on a different chapter in his life and moving away. And so we decided at that time we would go ahead and try to pursue filling the pulpit job. And had one of our members call me and say, you might want to listen to this guy and at least check him out. So that's what we're doing tonight. We're going to check him out. No pressure. No pressure at all. Spencer Ross is a 2008 graduate of the Brown Trail School of Preaching in Bedford. Spencer also received his BS in Management Communications in 2011 from Ambridge University and a Master's in Ministry from Heritage Christian University in 2017. He is currently pursuing a PhD in leadership with Johnson University. He's labored as a youth and family minister with the Bedford, Northwest, Fort Worth, and Keller Churches of Christ. Spencer currently serves as the director of Foreign Extension Schools with the World Bible Institute, or WBI, as well as a missions and outreach minister at the Northwest Church of Christ. Spencer has traveled and done mission work in 37 countries. He and his wife, Candace, were married in March 2009. They have three boys, Landon 12, Kaysen 8, Ryder 5, and one daughter, Emery 1. Spencer enjoys playing tennis, eating at restaurants, and spending time with his family. So now, if you would, give your attention to Spencer.
Well, it's great to be with the New York Avenue Church. I think I was here last summer when y'all hosted the Summer Youth Series. And I think the last time I was at this pulpit, I can't pinpoint it, but probably like 7 years ago, I came and did a Lads to Leaders presentation. Not sure if you remember that, but I know New York Avenue has a big presence when it comes to the L2L convention that we call Dallas, but now it's called the Fort Worth Convention. And it's such a joy to see you all there every Easter weekend. But I'm happy to share a lesson tonight. Let's see if it all pops up. There it is. There are certain books that I'm glad are not true. The book Harry Potter. We would be considered muggles, maybe a few half-bloods in here, but there would be a whole nother realm of wizards and witches that would want to get rid of our existence. I'm glad that the book The Cat in the Hat is not real. There'd be large felines that talk roaming our planet. Glad the book 1984 is not real. We'd have the government listening and watching everything we say. Well, that one actually probably is true, but what about this one? What about this book, a collection of books, 66 books making up what we call the Bible, the scriptures, two covenants, an Old and a New Testament, written over a period of 2,500 years, 40 different authors, three different languages, three different continents. Is this book true? I want to look at 5 points this evening. If the Bible is true, then what are the implications? 5 major implications that we want to examine today. If the Bible is true, number one, then God is the author. He must be the author. This book has to have a divine origin. There's no other way to go about it. This book would then be every word is completely inspired and breathed out by God. It has this uniformity, this story, this account, this narrative from creation all the way to eternity, from Genesis to Revelation. It's a word that claims to be from God over 1,000 times, thus saith the Lord, and derivatives of that statement. We see in scriptures like John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All scripture is breathed out or inspired by God, 2 Timothy 3 and verse 16. In Exodus 24, verse 4, Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. Isaiah 30, verse 8, God tells Isaiah to write the words of the Lord upon a tablet or scroll. 2 Samuel 23, verse 3, David stated, The Spirit of the Lord speaks to me. His word is upon my tongue. Or in the New Testament, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 and 21. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. That's the process of inspiration. God, via the Holy Spirit, inspiring human authors to record an original autograph, a writing, a book, a revelation that could be recorded and shared and spread and copied meticulously into countless manuscripts and translated into countless languages, even to this day where we still have those manuscripts printed in book form. God has to be the author. Either he's the author or it's a collection of human authors. It would be those 40 authors that were some sort of committee that conspired together to put together this this hoax, this long established plan from author to author. As one author died, they had to make sure the other author knew the plan to keep this whole story going about this message from a creator who was pointing to a coming Messiah, how a Messiah would come and he would offer salvation. But it was really a bunch of bad men that were together writing this book, which strangely enough was about a lot of good things. Or it would have to be a collection of just good people, a lot of good people that were, let's give people a message of hope, but let's write about good things that actually condemn ourselves because we know that we're not telling the truth. We know we're lying and we're going against the very thing in which we are writing. God is either the author of the Bible or he's not. And if the Bible is true in all of its attributes and dimensions of the Bible, it has to come from a divine source. You know, there was a study that came out, numerous studies, but one book in particular I want to reference in these first 2 points. It was kind of a disturbing and alarming book. I was doing some research on our young people about, you know, what are the statistics, the retention rates of whenever they graduate school and they go off into their next chapter of life, whether it be college or work. What are the percentages of them staying faithful to the Lord and faithful to the church? And there were a number of sources I went through. I used Flavel Yakeley's book, Why They Left. And then I looked in even across Christendom in a book called Already Gone by Ken Ham. He's a guy who does Answers in Genesis. And it was an alarming book because it's entitled Already Gone. Because when interviewing people who had left the faith, they had found out during those interview processes, they had said that they had already left. They were already gone as early as 13 years old to about the age of 18, sitting in the pews of their churches. They had come down to 2 main reasons why they had spiritually began to check out. It came down to number 1, they had began to doubt the complete inspiration of Scripture from a very young age. Perhaps it wasn't emphasized, perhaps answers weren't communicated, but from Genesis to Revelation, there was doubts. Is this really a God-breathed book? Can we trust that every single book has providentially been preserved in the Bible? And this was a critical study. It's something that it convinced me that more and more we need to do textual studies and to show with apologetics and other avenues that this book can be trusted. And it's not just something that's been put together in a kind of a smorgasbord history and been added to and supplemented. And maybe parts of it are inspired and maybe some of them aren't. And we kind of treat it the way that, kind of like a buffet, I like this, I don't like this. And you kind of like, parts of it surely aren't fully inspired. And when you express any doubt, you really are left with all these unknown answers. It's either God is the author or he's not the author. And so if the Bible is true, God is the author, number 1. Number 2, and it goes along with that same book study I want to start with, then God is the creator. When talking about fully inspired texts, it begins in Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then we have not a deep scientific textbook addressing every avenue of the intricacies of biology and chemistry and all the different ologies and means of learning. There's nothing wrong with any of that. It was a short, concise narrative explaining creation. Here's how creation started. Here's the origin of humans. Here's the origin of everything from the land and the seas and the waters and the plants and the trees and animals and humans. It was a short narrative, not intended, again, to be an extreme, ever-changing, new edition scientific textbook. But if the Bible is from God, then we accept God not only to be the creator, but that is the creation account in the very first chapter. See, in that book, Already Gone, the second topic of discussion that it was pleading with communicators, preachers, ministers, that with your young people to emphasize the creation account can be accepted as a literal account. Because if you doubt the first chapter to be not just allegorical or poetic, but if it's not inspired or a literal account of Genesis in creation, then how can you trust Genesis 2 through Revelation 22? See, is there anything that would suggest that Genesis 1 has another alternative view to creation? There's really only three options, I suppose, when it comes to creation. Either take God out of the picture, take the Genesis 1 out of the picture, and just rely solely on our studies from our human finite capabilities and our questions and the conclusions and the scientific method and the ever-changing and understanding method that we continue just to, what I would say, understand God's creation. You would have to eliminate God and rely solely on humanism and naturalism, which still has pitfalls because you don't even know ultimately the origin still. You don't really know where matter started, and you don't know, you already know even scientifically, matter eventually is going to wind down, and we have no answers for eternity going the other way. Genesis, or you could take this position, that you want to kind of combine two different worldviews, two different ideas. I believe in a creator, I believe in God, which all the evidence points to that, right? Romans chapter 1, verse 20, we know there's a creator based on the creation we can see with our eyes. We know that there's a God. But then it's like, wait a second, how do I fit my understanding and all these other different studies of academia and mix it and combine it into Genesis chapter 1? You want to try to have the best of both worlds. And people do that, and they honestly try to do that. It's theistic evolution. You want to have the ideas of macroevolution squeezed into Genesis 1 by either saying it's not literal or it's poetic, or you attribute long periods of time to each day of creation. And someone would tell, Spencer, you're telling me you don't believe in macroevolution? Could God not have used that as his means for explaining, you know, biology, study of life? I say, of course God could have done that. But is that what Genesis 1 teaches? Is there anything to suggest otherwise? See, when I read Genesis 1, and I believe every word to be inspired from God, it says that there was morning and there was evening the first day, morning and evening the second day, and so on to the seventh day. We read different things like the word, and specifically in Hebrew, yom means always a 24-hour period day, anytime it's put into scripture. Or in day number three, you have, you can sing that song, day three, God made flowers and plants and trees. Well, what do you need in order for flowers, plants, and trees to flourish and to grow and to be sustained? You need a sun, which if you attribute millions or billions, however many you want to squeeze into the narrative, of years, well, there was no sun until the next day. That means you had a world with all this vegetation and no sun for all those days. Or what about Adam? Adam was created on day six, and he was alive on day seven still. And the Bible even tells us in Genesis chapter 5 and verse number 3, when Adam died, he was 930 years old. Like, we know how old he was when he died. So what number of years do we put per day? And so what happens is we try so hard to squeeze our understandings and we try to mix it in into the scriptures, and you can't do it. You can't do it theologically speaking. And so if the Bible is true, then I have to accept the creation account that God is the creator, and it's a faith tenet. Hebrews 11, verse 3. Hebrews 11, verse 3 teaches us, by faith we understand that the universe was created by God so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. It's part of my faith. I have to accept and understand the creation account. Again, and because I do, I trust the rest of the text. But again, I'm kind of doing this as a hypothetical, so I'll continue to our third point. If the Bible is true, then God is the standard. And this point has to do more with ethics and morality. Terms like right and wrong, good and bad, correct or incorrect, all of those words mean nothing if there's no God. If you eliminate God, if you eliminate a standard in this world, you eliminate a coming judgment, if you eliminate moral teachings in Scripture, then there is no standard. There is no, words like right and wrong are really meaningless. Even in the most philosophical debates, when you take God out of the picture, ethics becomes very challenging to describe. and to implement, especially in a universal level. I mean, I have a book in my office called Ethics for Dummies. I mean, maybe you've seen the Dummies series, the yellow books. There's various topics. And I read through that and highlighted and marked it all up, trying to understand how to explain ethics without God. And of course, we would have to draw conclusions. Ethics is based on, is it based on feelings? Is it based on the culture you live in and what the majority of society deems as, quote unquote, right or wrong or good or bad? But the problem with that is it's not universal. It's always changing. The majority could hold a wrong position, but I can't even call it a wrong position because there's no standard. It doesn't matter how you live because there is no afterlife. There is no judgment. I can't tell anybody they're doing something wrong, just like they can't tell me what I'm doing wrong. They could say it's unpopular or not popular, but if you eliminate the standards of from Scripture, then morality becomes extremely difficult to talk about. I had someone tell me this even recently. You know, Spencer, you shouldn't be so judgmental. And I was trying to understand where they were coming from. It was from a Christian point of view. This is, the Bible says, didn't Jesus tell us to judge not? And I said, well, let's look what the Bible says. And I went to Matthew chapter 7 and verse number 1. And this is an often quoted passage, and I believe it's something that Christians are having a hard time communicating these days, where it says, judge not. And then oftentimes, and I believe sincerely and honestly, people put like a period there. Or they put like an exclamation mark or like two or three of them saying, judge not. But, you know, my Bible has a comma. That Jesus continues his thought. He says, judge not that you be not judged. What does he mean by that? Well, let's let Jesus speak. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. So what's Jesus talking about? He's talking about making a proper judgment using the right measurement. He's not saying to never judge or categorically never identify as something as right or wrong. Or even when somebody says, Spencer, you're judgmental, I'm like, well, you're making a judgment also. I mean, so are we allowed to say anything's right or wrong? What did Jesus say? He said to use the measure that we use on others will be used on us. So it's the same standard. That's what it's coming down to. What is that standard? Is it my opinion? Is it called a popular cultural opinion and popularity? Or is it John 12, verse 48? The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. Jesus is saying that his word is the standard in which Spencer or Chris or all of us in this room are going to be judged by equitably. It's going to be an equal standard for all of us. And so I'm not trying to use a different form of opinion or a different level. If I make any sort of discernment or distinction, or I, as Jesus said, you judge them by their fruits, the fruit. If I'm analyzing fruit, I'm using the same standard for myself as I will in all other people. I'm, and again, I don't say Spencer said, here's what the word of God says. That's the standard then. That's what in John chapter 7 and verse number 24, do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment. In other words, there's right judgment and there's wrong judgment. The proper judgment, which seems like a negative, bad word, but if we look at it in a scriptural sense, we use the standard as the word of God. So if the Bible is true, we are not left in the dark. We have the scriptures. We have the nature of God revealed in the word. See, if we did a full study on ethics today, which we're going to move on here in a moment, we would come to this idea in scripture, ethics, right and wrong, is based on the nature of God. As you define God, that's how you define right and wrong. So God does not lie, Titus 1:2. So therefore, if God is faithful and doesn't lie and he's consistent, it is immoral to be unfaithful and to lie and to not be consistent like that. Be holy, for I am holy. Leviticus 11, verse 44, quoted in 1 Peter 1, verse 16. Ethics is based on the nature of God. So we use him as the standard, and that's how we understand good and bad, good and evil. All of these terms, again, mean nothing if the Bible is not true. So if the Bible is true, then God is the standard. Okay, number four. If the Bible is true, then God is the Savior. And that term is used in Scripture. I kind of went back and forth and how to word this point. The standard, we read that in the Savior, Jude verse 25, God our Savior. In Titus 3, in verse number 4, it talks about God, our Savior. God established from the before the foundation of the world a plan of salvation. If the Bible is true, we have hope, is what that means. If the Bible is true, there is a scheme, a plan of redemption for you and me. That Jesus came, he died, he was buried, and the resurrection actually happened. Not only was Jesus historically a real person, but he actually conquered death. He showed that when you die, that's not the end. There's more to life after that. We have a Savior because of God. We have a resurrection truth that we can believe. The scriptures do not leave us in the dark in this whole idea of finding hope and meaning in this world. Whenever we attend a service, a memorial service for someone who's gone, we can go there with not a fake or temporary sense of they're in a better place or to make people temporarily feel good. No, it's real and it's eternal, and there is life after death, and I can be reunified with people I've known who've been faithful to the Lord in the past. We have a Savior is what it means. We're not left in the dark when it comes to life and its meaning and its origin and its destination. If the Bible is true, then God is the Savior. Number five, if the Bible is true, then God is the Eternal One. He is the Eternal One. Yahweh is the great I Am. I Am is in the present tense. So whether we're talking about God yesterday, he was the I Am. He was present right then. We're talking about him right now, July 3rd, 2022. He is I Am. He is right now. He is present. We talk about him tomorrow. He's still the I Am. He was the I Am in time of Moses, during the time when Jesus said in John 8, verse 58, he is the I Am. Or if it be in 100 years from now and the Lord doesn't return, he's still the I Am. He is the Eternal One. God does not change. Malachi 3, verse 6. Hebrews 13, verse 8. Our God does not change. Him yesterday, today, and tomorrow. A characteristic of deity. We have an eternal God. We change, people change, practices change, positions and values and ethics change over time. But what does not change is the Eternal One. God is the one who continues to be the consistent one. And he's the eternal God that we follow and serve. If the Bible is true, then we know there's going to be a time of judgment. In Matthew 25, verse 46, there'll be a separation of the sheep and goats. And there's an adjective that's used to describe the destination of the different groups of people. And it's the word eternal. In Matthew 25, verse 46, eternal life or eternal punishment. Which one will it be? And we have eternity that we can have with the Eternal One. So pretty simple thoughts here as we're looking at this concept of if the Bible is true, then major implications with the God being an author and a creator and a standard, the Savior and the Eternal One. I'll just kind of pose the opposite question here. If the Bible is not true, the Bible's not true. And what does that mean then? I mean, obviously this book is historically fascinating. We can't deny, if you're very honest and you're a skeptic, you can't deny that the text isn't consistent. It continues to show that this is an authentic book through all the countless manuscripts that we have, not only in Greek, but the even different versions and the different translations. I love archaeology. We should embrace it. We should love it. All it does is support the text is authentic. It's been preserved and it's continued to be preserved and copied properly. And we can trust what we have in our hands or in your phones right now. But does that mean it's from God? Well, it would have to be. We made a whole point about that. It would have to be from a divine origin because of its consistency, its lack of contradictions, its literary excellence, its consistency with history and archaeology and scientific foreknowledge, all what I call puzzle pieces of inspiration. You put all those pieces together and you get this beautiful picture of inspiration. If the Bible is not true, then what is it? It's just another religious book. It's a religious, philosophical book trying to explain life. It's just as equal as a Quran or the Book of Mormon or the Humanist Manifesto. It's just another document trying to explain religion for humans. It's just a bunch of minds that have come together to put together this text. Now, it's different because it's been preserved and it's quite incredible. So it's either from a divine origin or it's not. If the Bible's not true, then really we're left in the dark when it comes to creation, a creator. We don't know anything about intelligent creation. We We left completely in the dark. No matter how brilliant we become, we cannot reenact, even using scientific method, creation again. You can't test that again. Like we will be always have a level of unknowingness in our minds. We will be so limited in our finite understanding about our origin. We'll never know. And this whole life is obviously meaningless if you take any sort of higher power out of it. It's just about the here and now. If the Bible's not true, then, as I've already noted, we have no standard for ethics. We can't tell any individual, any act, or any type of living or lifestyle as wrong or sinful in it. You can't do it whenever you have no acknowledgement of God and His scriptures. This is one of the discussions I'm having with people when it comes to ethics. There's two different ways I describe it. One is when I'm talking to Christians, because if they're a Christian, they hopefully believe this to be true, and we can actually have a reasonable discussion from the Word. And then I talk about ethics with people who aren't Christians. It's a little different ballgame. You can't quote scripture for that to be your motivation for why we should live like this or not live like this. I have to get them to accept a creator first, then we can talk about the creator's message, and then we can talk about what it actually teaches. So if the Bible's not true, there is no standard in this world. There is no right. There is no wrong. If the Bible is not true, why are we here right now? You being here on a Sunday afternoon is vain. We're sitting here with a group of people that we care about, but it's just a social club is all this is. And we believe that Jesus rose from the dead, but the resurrection didn't happen if the Bible's not true. Actually, Paul would say in 1 Corinthians 15, we are the most pitied people because we're like living our lives centered around the resurrection. But if it didn't happen, what are we doing? You have no hope. It's not real hope. It's just a little level of make you feel okay when you go to sleep tonight, but really there's no grasp of confidence that we have in our salvation. If the Bible is not true, there is no eternity that awaits us. I mean, it's just the here and now. We live and we die. That's a bleak, dark outlook on life. I mean, it's a belief that people choose to follow. I don't believe in God. Don't believe in the Bible. I'm not a religious person. I had somebody literally say that to me yesterday. It's just sad. I go back to the time before I became a Christian. What did I convince myself of? I had to be in some kind of denial. I had to like justify my life in some way before I came to the acknowledgement of God is real and His word is true and I need to obey this gospel. But it's a sad life when you eliminate the reality of this message. We are left completely hopeless. So, if the Bible is not true. But since the Bible is true, we'll conclude with this. It changes everything. It changes everything. My whole worldview is centered around the truth of Scripture now. It's centered around the fact that this is something I can believe the message that it communicates. And it has this whole story centered around Jesus, the Old Testament pointing to the Messiah coming. Jesus is here in Matthew through John. Jesus is coming again from Acts to Revelation into the last days that we're living in right now. We're in those last days. I have a worldview centered around the lens of Scripture. I see the world through the Bible. I see the world through eternity. I see the world through a creator who's not just a deistic creator who made everything and then is just kind of sitting back and watching with an hourglass turned over. No, one that is intimately and providentially involved in the affairs of man, and he wants humans to be saved and redeemed and to experience life and know that it's goodness as he said it was when he created it. And Jesus said you can have life, but not only life, but an abundant life. John 10 in verse number 30. Since the Bible is true, it helps me make my daily decisions, little and big. It helps me to understand how to guide my family, how to work in the kingdom in various ways and preaching and evangelism, because everybody now becomes a soul, someone who's created in the image of God. I live my whole life making temporary, present day choices with eternity in mind. I experience a sense of happiness and blessedness, knowing I'm not immune from issues and tragedy and trials, but I can handle it a lot different than somebody who doesn't have that confidence, doesn't have that sense of hope. Since the Bible is true, it changes everything. I can say that I am redeemed. I have been born again. I have rose in a newness of life when it came out of that the waters of baptism. I have purpose. God can use me to be his hands and his feet and his mouth in this world. So since the Bible is true, it means everything. It means everything. So this is just a simple message, but it has profound implications. During this song of invitation, let's skip ahead and see what it was called. He lifted me, 2:21. If you have been doubting the scriptures for various reasons, I know people here, myself included, would be happy to study the text with you. They get you in the word and let the word of God, which is sharper than any two-edged sword, pierce your soul and spirit. You can find and understand the God-breathedness of the word. If you need that guidance, people will be here happy to help you with that. If you have been convinced and convicted by the truth and the word has pricked your heart, but you've never confessed Jesus as Lord, you've never experienced the Savior, I assume there's a baptistry here. Yes, right behind me. It would take just but a few moments. That's all it takes, a few minutes to just say, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. I'm going to surrender myself completely to him. You're going to die to your old self in water because Jesus did the hard part for us. He literally, physically died on the cross for you and me. Therefore, the wages of sin was satisfied in Jesus, and we don't have to go through that. And we can be born again because Jesus rose from the dead. We too can rise in a newness of life. That is something that can happen this evening. If you have a prayer request, if you want to identify and work and worship here under the eldership, there's all kinds of things you can do during a formal invitation. But God's invitation is always open 24/7. And we learn that in the scriptures, not because of me. Jesus said, come, you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. So why don't we all stand and sing? If you're subject to an invitation, you can come forward.
Thank you. Let's pray. Our Father, first and foremost, we ask you to please be with our members who are traveling this summer and going back and forth. They're part of our family and we love them. Please keep them safe. Lord, be with all of us as we go through the week, and especially tomorrow, as we are so fortunate to live in a country with so many privileges and so many blessings we cannot even comprehend. Lord, please forgive us when we complain and moan and groan and think that we have it hard, because we have it so good in this country. Lord, I thank you so much for the elders and their wives and all the effort and the work and the things they do at this church, that they stand up and they lead. And they lead this church because they love this church. Lord, again, please be with us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.